Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now here is Pastor Arnold Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Say welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this family Bible study hour. Back in our Father's Word, Book of Matthew, chapter 13. This probably is one of the most important chapters in Father's Word. It helps you to understand the plan of God, basically, the foundation of it. As a matter of fact, in Mark chapter 4, Christ there says, if you don't understand this parable of the sower and the tares, you're not going to understand any of the parables. It would be impossible for you to have the whole package wrapped up of God's plan without understanding this chapter. Now, we're into the subject of the earth, the planting, and it says that the kingdom of heaven is like unto a man who sowed good seed, and an enemy came and sowed bad seed. And the word seed here changes. It's a little different in the Greek. It's sperma. So you know you're talking about children, all right? And of course, we know from horticulture that the tares are zawan. And zawan, when it grows, it looks exactly like wheat. But when they both produce grain, one is golden and we use it for food, and the other, the tares, the one, it's black and it's poison. What a difference. But while they're growing, you can't tell the difference, and that's what God wants you to know. It's real difficult sometimes to tell the difference. All children are His, and if anything, it's our job to convert them, not destroy them. At this time yet, okay? So, but the point being made, you can't, while you're here on earth and until the very end when the fruit is produced, you can't tell the difference, basically. You can spiritually, though, all right? Good clue for you. All right, let's go with the next verse we were coming to. Verse 26, word of wisdom from our Father, and verse 26 concerning the tares reads, but when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares also. I mean, boy, you could tell the difference then. Verse 27, so the servants of the householder came and said unto him, sir, didst not thou sow good seed in thy field? From whence then hath it tares? What is this poison doing in here? And again, I want to reiterate, the word seed here is sperma, meaning children. Verse 28, he said unto them, an enemy hath done this. The servant said unto him, wilt thou that we go and gather them up? Verse 29, but he said, nay, no way, lest while you gather up the tares, you root up also the wheat with them. Meaning, you really can't tell the difference until they produce fruit. This is why you have to buy their fruit, you shall know them. This is why you are taught to test the fruit. Verse 30, let both, this is his instructions, let both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares, and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. Remember back in chapter 3, verse 12, what it said there? I'm going to go back there real quick. Chapter 3, verse 12, and chapter 3, verse 12 reads, concerning Christ, whose fan is in his hand, that's a threshing fan, winnowing fan, and he will thoroughly purge his floor, that's the thrashing floor, and gather his wheat into the garner, that's his barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. a consuming fire. God is a consuming fire. So he's able to handle it. He's able to take care of it. So there you have the parable of the tares. Then who is this wicked seed? And naturally, you know, as a servant of God, it's Kenites, which is to say the sons of Cain. Verse 31, another parable, listen carefully. Another parable put he forth unto them, saying, the kingdom of heaven, that's the king and his dominion of in heaven, is like unto a grain of mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field. Smallest seed among the herbs, okay? Well, and this says it, verse 32. Which indeed is the least of all seeds, but when it is grown, it is greatest among the herbs, and becometh a tree, so that the birds of the air come and lodge in the branches thereof. And naturally, the mustard seed, as you sow it, anytime you sow mustard is good. So that you get a better picture in this part, in the Middle East and near Jerusalem, mustard grew to where it would be up to a man on a horseback, okay? So it did grow actually up into a tree there, basically. Not a huge tree, but among a tree for an herb. But what is the meaning then? If you start a work for God, though it's good, then before it is done and before it is over, you will have the false ones, actually the tares, come and they'll roost in it. They'll try to destroy it. So you have to be on guard in a good church, for Satan will send his little emissaries and they will try to roost in the branches of the house of God, not to help it, but to entangle it and to destroy it if it was possible. It's not possible. Not if you have true people of God heading it. So there you have it. Verse 33, let's go with another parable. He's giving, and if you don't understand these, again, you won't understand any of God's parables. Another parable spake he unto them, the kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven, which a woman took and hid in three measures of meal till the whole was leavened. Now, sometimes naturally leaven is usually equated as sin, so you have to take this in the negative sense. So we'll use it in the negative sense. You can have your whole church designed, but if you let a little leaven into it, it'll permeate through the whole congregation. So you can't allow that. It just can't happen. Now, if we were to take this in the good sense, which is not correct, but we're going to do it anyway, because if you take a group that is kind of misled and let a little truth into the congregation, that will begin to spread the real truth, and it will also spread. This should not be taught, though, in that positive sense, though it is a fact, because leaven is always related to sin in the negative sense. And so be it. Verse 34. All these things spake Jesus unto the multitude in parables, and without a parable spake he not unto them. You would have to understand the meaning before it would have any, would increase your knowledge. Okay. Verse 35. Why? Here's the answer. That it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, I will open my mouth in parables, I will utter things that have been kept secret from the foundation of the world. They're quoted from Psalm 78, okay. There is an interesting thing here, and you need to study God's word in more depth. What does it mean it was hidden in secret from the foundation? What is this word foundation in the manuscripts? It is a word that you hear me use many times, and I'm not going to show it to you on the character generator, because I want you to look it up yourself in your Strong's Concordance. It is the word 2602. And its prime is 2598, which means what? 2602 is cuttable, the falling, and from the prime, it's the overthrow. In other words, it was the overthrowing of Satan himself. This has been kept secret since then, of what Satan would do, the wicked seed that would be planted and so forth. But you need to get yourself in gear and check that out for yourself so that you see it with your own eyes and lock it into your own mind. I'll give you the word again. It's the word foundation, of course, in the English. But in the Greek manuscripts, you will find it as 2602 and coming from the prime 2598. And it means the overthrow in the first earth age. Not just a little overthrow, the whole thing. So, what is the secret then? Well, you pretty well already had it with the parables, but let's see how the disciples take this. 36, then Jesus sent the multitude away. You don't have the multitude here any longer. And he went into the house, and his disciples came unto him, saying, declare unto us the parable of the tares of the field. Not even they totally got it, but here we only have his students. So he's not going to be speaking in a parable. He's going to be explaining one. It's important that you absorb that. He's not going to be teaching in a parable. He will be explaining a parable. Verse 37. He entered and he said unto them, he that soweth the good seed is the Son of Man. In other words, that is God. Son of Man is usually Christ as he walked the earth in the flesh, okay? The Holy Spirit with the Son was when the creation took place. And of course, the seed here being the sperma, so we're talking about children, okay? Verse 38, the field is the world. Oh, well now that, which means world age, okay? The good seed are the children of the kingdom. Well, who would the children of the kingdom be? Well, naturally, it would be God's elect and those that believe on Almighty God. And they are children here, all right? Children of the living God. But the tares, but the tares are the children of the wicked one. Well, now, who wonder the wicked one could be? I think most everyone knows. Naturally, but in as much as he's explaining a parable instead of teaching one, he himself will tell you, verse 39, the enemy that sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the world, this world age, eon. And the reapers are the angels. This is why that you leave them alone, but who is this and what could we be speaking of here? Naturally, he's saying the enemy sowed the seed. Well, then we know who could he be talking about? Well, have you ever read John chapter 8? John chapter 8, verse 42. You're not going to have it, but make a note of it. John chapter 8, verse 42. Did Jesus ever say, this is Christ talking now. Verse 42, Jesus said unto them, if God were your father, this is those that claim to be of our brother Judah and were indeed lying. If God were your father, you would love me. For I proceeded forth and came from God, neither came I of myself, but he sent me. 43, why do you not understand my speech? Even because you cannot hear my word, your ears are closed. 44, how sharp are you? You don't have to be very sharp. A child can understand. Verse 44, you are of your father, the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning. Well, now let's see. Who was the first murderer? Duh. Well, naturally, it was Cain, and his offspring are Kenites. So now we know who the seed is and who sowed it. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth. But because there is no truth in him, and when he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. And because I tell you the truth, you believe me not. Which of you convinceth me of sin? And if I say the truth, why do you not believe me? He that is of God heareth God's word. Ye therefore hear them not, because ye are not of God. In other words, it's Satan's seed. Well, dear goodness, what you mean Satan had seed here on earth? Well, have you ever studied the Bible? Have you ever read Genesis chapter 3? The first prophecy that was given by Almighty God, the first prophecy in the Bible. What does it say? Verse 15 of chapter 3, the great book of Genesis, in the beginning. And I will put, he's speaking to the serpent, and I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. So here we have Satan wholly seduced, as it is written, beguiled Eve. And how that, well, do you mean that the serpent had seed? Well, that's what God said. Now let me tell you something. You'll have people that will make light of serpent seed. Then they're not Bible students. They haven't read Genesis, for this is God speaking, our Heavenly Father, and he's making it very clear here that the serpent has children, and we see where they originated from. That isn't, you know, there were seven churches in the great book of Revelation, and there was only two out of those seven that were approved of by Jesus Christ. Does your church teach what those two churches taught? If it doesn't, you're in a heap of hurt. The church of Smyrna, in chapter 2, I'm going to pick it up with verse 9. I know thy work, speaking of this church, and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich, and I know blasphemy of them which say they are of Judah, our brother Judah, and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan and the offspring of Satan, the serpent seed. Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer, because the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that you may be tried, and you shall have tribulation 10 days, and only 10 days. And again, when you go on to chapter 3, to the church of Philadelphia, that's the only other church that Christ found approval with. If you're in one of the others, you're in a heap of hurt. But he would say to the church of Philadelphia, those that have the key of David, that openeth and no man shutteth, and shutteth and no man open. I know thy works, in verse 8. Behold, I have set before thee an open door. This, you can see the seed and understand the beginning and the parables. And no man can shut it, for thou hast a little strength and has kept my word and has not denied my name, because I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are of our brother Judah and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet. Why would they worship at your feet? Because you're at the feet of Christ. It is he that they're worshiping. Why? On the first day of the millennium, every knee, cannot null, will bow to the living God. It won't stay there, but when they recognize and realize. Now, these are the teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it is amazing to me that how few people that claim to be Christians are aware of this. They don't understand that parable, and it is put forth so simply in this 13th chapter, from verse 37 to 42, that a child can understand it, because Christ lays it out in a way that you couldn't miss. So it becomes important. Well, what does this really do? It identifies your enemy. You know where Satan and who he works through and around when you're familiar with this teaching. And it assists you in teaching truth, because overall it is the plan of God. Who will follow God and who will follow Satan? He has his evil spirits and God has his Holy Spirit. Satan has his children, the Kenites, and God has his children, the elect, and naturally he is the father of all. But some have fallen. That's what that katabo, that word foundation translated, means, the overthrow. When Satan became so evil, he had to overthrow that first earth age, as it is written in Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 18 and 19. The overthrow itself spoken of in Jeremiah chapter 4, verse 18, 19, and forward. So there you have it. It's so simple to understand. Maybe then you can begin to understand the world a little better and how that these, the enemies of God try to, they would still today cry, crucify him. Then you can recognize why they said it. They were the seed of the enemy, the children of the enemy, and the deeds of their father they will do. Okay, returning into that 13th chapter of Matthew, the next verse up, please, would be verse 40. As therefore the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so shall it be in the end of this world. Now, there is nothing wrong that a minister, it'll really check him out if he can convert a tare or not, because they are convertible. You can really feel like you've accomplished something if you can truly convert one. Then instead of being a child of the devil, they become a child of the living God. Verse 41, the Son of Man shall send forth his angels, that's the Lord Jesus Christ will send forth the angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, and them which do iniquity. So there you have it. Who does iniquity? Those that worship the Antichrist. That's a sin. So you want to be very careful. That's why this particular chapter is so potent. And this is why Revelation becomes so important, that you understand the sixth trump and the seventh especially. If you don't understand any of the others, you should know the sixth and the seventh. Why? Because the sixth trump is Satan's trump. 666, six seal, six trump, six vial. Christ's trump is the seventh, when the true Christ returns and is what is called the second advent. So how precious it is to follow God's word. Iniquity is those that fall short. And if you do not know and understand what's about to transpire, when we get to the 24th chapter, you're going to wake up and you're going to see a lot going on, if you have eyes to see and ears to hear, and if you can understand this parable. So let's continue then to the next verse, 42. And shall cast them into a furnace of fire. God is a consuming fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. A lot of people are going to be very disappointed at this time, and so it is that with the deception, it comes real hard, that that fiery furnace, the lake of fire, it simply is to destroy. Have your time in sequence here so that you know what we're talking about. The lake of fire does not come into being until the last day of the millennium. So that is 1,000 years after the second advent. That is to say, after the true Christ returns to this earth. And there will be a lot of teaching in that time, so don't prejudge anybody. God's elect have a lot of work to do, teaching with Christ, as it's written in Revelation 20, verse 5. 1,000 years with Christ as priest, teaching, helping, trying to drag people back away from the abyss, and with the beautiful truth of loving our Heavenly Father, which is really what he requests and what he desires. So how blessed it is. Verse 43 to continue. Then shall the righteous shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Who hath ears to hear, let him hear. Now, it's important that you know also how good our Father is. Everything that offends and everything that brings hurt to our people is done away with at that time. That's why they can shine and come forth with the beauty of our Heavenly Father, knowing He's in charge, He's in control. And certainly we have nothing to be concerned about, because there won't be anything left there that does offend after that time. That's why it's so precious that you want to inherit eternal life and be a citizen of that kingdom whereby you can shine forth as the sun in happiness, in joy, and in completeness. Verse 44, how about another parable? Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure hid in a field, the which when a man hath found, he hideth and for joy thereof, he goeth and selleth all that he hath and buyeth that field. What he's telling you is, in the meaning of that parable, that treasure in the field is the world. And that treasure is the truth. The truth of knowing who the seed of the serpent are, who they are. To know who your enemies are. To know that you will not be deceived when the false one appears on this earth claiming to be Christ. That false teaching will not draw you into some flyaway doctrine which God is against, as it is written in Ezekiel chapter 13, verse 20 through 25, but that you have work to do for our Heavenly Father, and you'll learn what that work is when we get to the 24th chapter. But you would give all for that truth. Why? Because that truth is the wealthiest thing you'll ever own, because it brings the blessings of God on you and your family, whereby you can prosper in all things if you truly believe and work at it. The treasure's worth it. Then verse 45, how about another one? Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant man seeking goodly pearls. In other words, that's his business. He's an expert. He's in that business. He knows what a pearl is when he sees it. He knows what the best pearl is when he sees it. That's what this is like. Verse 46, who, when he had found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. In other words, it was worth everything he had. You don't have to sell everything you have. God paid the price. It's free to you to receive that truth from God. And yet it is as precious as that one pearl. If you gave everything for it, you would gain everything, heaven, the world, and all, because you had that precious pearl of great price, the truth from God's word, knowing who your enemies are, knowing what you must do not to offend. You don't bother them, you leave them alone. You can't tell the difference, basically, other than if God gifts you spiritually, that you have spiritual discernment, then you can tell, certainly, and know. But it's just precious the way our Father speaks to us and lets us know how precious the truth is, and truly it is. Well, how could it be? Because it gives you eternal life. I know many people think they have eternal life, but they are told they don't even have to study the book of Revelations or even God's word, basically, that they're going to be gone when the end happens. And unfortunately, that's not true, because that's Satan's message when he comes at the sixth trump, saying, I've come to fly you out of here. And you don't want to go there. You want to stand against him. The only two churches in the book of Revelation that Christ was happy with stood against them. Let's go with another one. Next verse, 47. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a net that was cast into the sea and gathered of every kind good, bad, and the ugly, all in one bundle. Verse 48, which when it was full, they drew to shore and sat down and gathered the good into vessels, into God's house, but cast the bad away. In other words, it's a time of separation. And socially, you separate yourself from their beliefs and bring yourself into the belief of Almighty God. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying and become isolated that you don't go to a sinner to help them. That's not what it's saying. But it's saying that when God returns and those that have loved him, fish is always a fish is symbolic of Christianity. The cipher is Christ himself as Savior of the children. And the good are going to be put in God's house and the others are going to be cast away. They're gone. That's why that this parable is, these parables are priceless, because they gain you, if you believe and follow and accept, they gain you eternal life with the Heavenly Father. It doesn't get any better than that. That's why it is so precious. Next verse, please, verse 49. So shall it be at the end of the world. The angel shall come forth and sever the wicked from among the just. There's a separation coming, and that separation is a good thing. If they've had every opportunity, and the end does not come until the end of the millennium. Verse 50, and shall cast them into the furnace of fire, that's the wicked, there shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth, and there certainly will be. Do you know why? Because a lot of them will believe that they were serving Christ. They're going to come to him at when he returns and say, oh, Jesus, we're so glad to see you. We've cast out demons in your name. And he's going to say, depart from me. I never knew you. Why? Because they worship the wrong Jesus. They're not even taught that the false Messiah comes first. And they're easy prey for the wicked one. Yep. There's two different seeds. You want to be careful. Christ made it very plain. This is not the teachings of a man. This is the teachings of Almighty God, delivered by the word that became flesh and walked among us, Messiah himself, the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, don't miss the next lecture. Bless your heart. You listen a moment, won't you please?
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the mark of the beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It is getting late in the game. You need to know what the mark of the beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. There is no need for you to be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13, 23, behold, I have foretold you all things. Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject, the mark of the beast. The telephone call is free. The CD is free. We don't even ask for the shipping and handling. It is free as well. All you need to do is call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also request your free CD by mailing your request to Shepherd's Chapel, Post Office Box 416, Gravett, Arkansas 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
And there we are back again. Let's have the 800 number, please. 1-800-643-4645. That number is good from Puerto Rico, throughout the U.S., Alaska, Hawaii, all over Canada. Spirit moves. You got a question, you share it. Won't you do that? Please never ask a question about a particular reverend or denomination or organization. We don't judge people. We don't have to. God does. He is the judge. You have the right to spiritually discern. That is a gift from God. There was never a better time to be blessed with spiritual discernment than in this age today, the parable of the fig tree generation. You certainly can be appreciative of it. Those of you that listen by shortwave around the world, it's always a pleasure hearing from you, and your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. It's always a pleasure to hear from you. Now, got a prayer request, you don't need that number and you don't need an address. Why? God knows what you're thinking right now. He always does. You don't even have to say it out loud. He loves you. He created you different than anyone else. Your fingerprints are different. Your DNA is different. You're unique. He wants you to love him, and he will certainly return that love with blessings. Father, around the globe we come. We ask that you lead, guide, direct, Father. Touch in Yeshua's precious name. Thank you, Father. Amen. Okay, and question times. And we're going to go with Doreen from Colorado. I thank our Heavenly Father every day for bringing you into, well, you're very welcome, Dennis also. This letter is also written to inform you that I wish to join your church. God told me yes, so is it okay? Hey, we would never argue with God. If God received you, he is the head of this church. That's why it's called the Shepherd's Chapel, because the shepherd is the head, and when you go to him and he says you're okay, you're in, you're a member, and we're welcome aboard. It's good to have you with us. Janet from New York. My question is, at the seventh trump, when we all go to spirit bodies, does that mean all flesh, as all life, pets, cattle, horses, cats, and so forth? Everything is changed instantly into spiritual bodies. This is why, as it is written in Isaiah chapter 11 concerning even the animals, that there are no more carnivores, because they're in a different body, which quite frankly, for those that want to peek just a little deeper, it's a different dimension even. But they're there, and thank God for it. God loves his animals. Patty from California, what is your opinion of what's happening with Chick-fil-A? Well, it is a, you know, Christians are Christians, and unfortunately other people are other people. And Christians must always stick together. There's a lot more of us than there is other people. We have a majority in this great nation. A lot of people would argue that point, but so be it. But you should, if you've never tasted chicken filet, you should try it. It's fantastic, and they have units all over the country. Now, they don't open on Sunday, and they don't believe in same-sex marriage, and that's what got them in trouble. The president of the company is family-owned. That's why it's such good chicken. And if you're a Christian, you need to make a stand. We cannot let perversion take over this world. It's not going to. God will hold us accountable if we don't make a stand. So, hey, sometime through the week, try a little chicken and make it be chicken filet, and you'll be happy you did. God will be happy you did. It's good to be Christian. It's clean and it's wholesome, and it brings the blessings from our Heavenly Father. It brings the truth whereby we can share that truth with no offense to anyone. You know, Christians are Christians. Leave them alone and you'll be fine. But you mess with them and we're all one family. Anyone that wants to put something off on this belief or that belief, that believes in Christ, you're going to have all of us down on you. It's time, and we're there. Richard from Texas, question. In the first world age, did God's children live here on earth side by side with the dinosaurs? Absolutely. We know we have found the angels' footprints in stone over 50,000 years old. And it is written in Jeremiah chapter 4 that Noah's flood wasn't the first big flood. It was the katabole that we spoke of in today's lecture, the overthrow. And you can read of it in Jeremiah chapter 4, as I told you before, beginning with verse 18. I'd like for you to pick that one up because it lets you know why most people can't understand. Sodish means just a little bit stupid, okay? And you'll understand what I mean. But it's very clear and the truth is brought forward. You see, in that first overthrow flood, There wasn't not one city, not one person, nothing, not a zippo left. In Noah's flood, there was two of every flesh plus Noah's family, doves, two of everything, and even the olive tree. In just a short period, like 5 months, a branch was brought back by a dove. Not everything was totally destroyed, in other words, except the hybrids that were created by the fallen angels and those that had mixed with them. Joanne from North Carolina. Do you think it is possible that God only destroys only the Adamic people in the whole earth? Your teachings have been a blessing to my life. No, he. If you read Genesis chapter 6, and you look at, naturally, the Adamic, Eth Ha'adam, his family is through which Christ would come. That's why God singles that family out, that man's destiny, all through God's word, and follows it, because it would be Christ that would come through this, and he is the Savior of all whom will believe. But you will note, as it would say, that Noah is the only Adamic family that had a perfect generation, which means pedigree. He, his sons, nor their wives or his wife had mixed with any of the fallen angels. So if they were the only ones, yet everything else was destroyed because of the mixing and the hybrids that were present there from the fallen angels. It wasn't natural, of course. God doesn't like anything that's perverted. That's the way our God operates, okay? Al from Mississippi. I would like to know, do I have to sow a seed to produce a harvest of blessings from the Lord? How do I go about sowing that seed to produce a harvest of blessings from the Lord? Well, sowing a seed is certainly not money, okay, as some might teach you. Sowing a seed is hearing the truth. That's what's precious. Money is not precious. God's word is precious. And when you can share that truth that changes lives, then that's the most valuable thing in the world. That is sowing a seed that will reap you a harvest. Now, you don't have to stand on some street corner. God will send, you know, people can tell when you have the Holy Spirit in you and you have the truth, and people begin to ask questions of bewilderment concerning world conditions, you got the answer. And they're drawn to you for that reason. But there are different gifts other than sowing seed even. It's simply being a servant of the living God. And being a witness, Matthew 24 soon will show why many people have been called and have a destiny, and it's planting seeds in a big way, being delivered up before the false Christ. Some of you have had a destiny and you've known it since you were a child, that there was more to God's word than you had been taught. Well, we're in that parable of the fig tree generation, and it's time it was taught. Daniel in the great book, he said, Daniel, close the book, you're not going to understand, but the wise shall understand in the end. This is it, and wisdom does come forth. Herbert from California, is it a sin to play the lotto? Well, is it your, you know, it is a sin if it's your children's grocery money. It's a sin if it's an habitual habit with you. But if it's $2 that is your recreation money, that you've already taken care of the family and everything, then whatever you do with your what pleases you, then there's no sin in that, as long as it is not evil. And certainly the lotto or playing it with your pleasure money, there's nothing wrong with that. But don't be an habitual gambler. That's when it becomes a sin, when something becomes habitual. Jay from Georgia, were we angels before God put us here on earth? We were in spirit bodies. The word angel means messenger. Okay, that's what an angel really, really is. And God does use people in spiritual bodies as messengers. This is why Daniel and even John fell on their knees and started worshiping one of them. They said, "Whoa, whoa, no, no, don't do that. I'm just like you are." They had been on earth and they were now with the Father in spirit form, and you wouldn't want someone to worship you, nor do they want to be worshiped either. That's what we are when we're with the Father. William from North Carolina, where can I find Adam's genealogy? Well, it's real simple. You will find Cain's genealogy, that's the wicked seed, in Genesis chapter 4. Then in the closing verse of 4, Adam's genealogy comes into play. You will find in this that Cain is not mentioned in Adam's genealogy because Cain was not Adam's son. A lot of people not understanding the manuscripts miss that point. That's fine. Not everybody is supposed to see and not everybody is supposed to hear. But if you do, you can find it quite easy. You would simply say, why isn't Cain mentioned in Adam's genealogy? Because he's not of Adam. That's just, a child can understand that. Then in today's lecture, you found out whose child he was. Richard from Texas. Does the Bible ever say that Mary Magdalena was a prostitute? Absolutely not. I do not know how all this gets started. I guess it's by preachers that are not educated, that preach their call Mary Magdalena a prostitute, and I guess they like the word or something or need something to shout about. But they would show their ignorance if they said something of that nature. It is written that she had seven demons. I mean, seven evil spirits in her, is better said. And naturally, it was a snap for Christ to drive those out and stop that poor girl from suffering. And she was so loyal to him. And how precious it was. She was not a prostitute. Men have a way of biblically calling women prostitutes. And if you were a real student of God's word, there's one or two of them you know definitely was not. But man just likes to use his own words. I guarantee you, God didn't call Mary Magdalena a prostitute. God himself didn't call Hagar a prostitute. Man did, okay? Jeannie from Georgia. I've written to you before, thanking you for preaching. You're so welcome. My question, a friend of mine, several years back, borrowed money from me, a total of $654. Since then, on various occasions, he has come into money, but they've never paid mine back. What should I do? Well, if you do not have a church to arbitrate this for you, naturally you could take it to small claims court. But unfortunately, sometimes when you take things to court, if you had to have a lawyer, he would charge you more than that to represent you. But you can go to small claims and represent yourself. But quite frankly, I would do the Christian thing. I would just jot her or him a note and say, I need that money. Times are hard, and it was given to you and as a help aid, and I need it back. And make your wishes known. That may not do any good, but at least you did your part, and God will bless you clear out of your bonnet the other way. Jeff from Michigan, and thank you for your comments. Would you please explain why there are so many names for our Father, and should we use one instead of another when talking or praying to him? Well, if you know what they are, you could. For example, many names are titles. His real name is Yahweh. It comes from the etymology of I am that I am, because he is whatever he wishes to be, wherever he wants to be, and whenever he wants to be. And he will do whatever he has to do. But example, Yahweh Jireh means God that provides. And you can go in your Strong's Concordance and start picking up Yahweh names as titles. And if you wish to use them, it's fine. But naturally, you need to know what they are. The word El, E-L, is not God's name, but it is translated God in English. But it's a title. So you need to know the difference in titles and names. And of course, then comes the Son's name, Jesus. Jesus is English. And what is it in the manuscripts? It's Yeshua. And Yeshua means Yahweh, that's God's name, Savior. So it is well to use these names, but if you are a teacher, you must use whatever language the people you're teaching that do not know what the sacred names are, you must use that whereby they'll know what you're talking about, because it is impossible to be a teacher and not be able to communicate, because teaching is communicating. So it is really left up to you to learn the difference in the titles. You know, we're really blessed in the manuscripts in the book of Esther by having the sacred name hidden five times in the manuscripts in an acrostic. And those of you with companion Bibles, it's real easy for you to check that out in the appendix. Okay, Kathy from Texas. I am still unclear about what trumpet, seal, and vial we are now in. I thought I heard you say the fifth seal the other day. Could you please explain this again? Because the fifth seal is a time of teaching who Satan is. In the fifth seal, you and Trump, you are given both his name in both Greek and Hebrew, whereby you know who that evil one is that will reign as the false Messiah. And naturally, we cannot be, and this is being taught. That's what it is. It's a time of teaching and sealing people in their forehead with truth. But when the sixth happens, then that is when Satan himself appears on earth give or take days. And that will not happen. So naturally, we're still in the fifth because Satan isn't here. His evil spirit is. But de facto, he still has not been kicked from heaven. Revelation chapter 12, verse 6 and 7. George from Rhode Island. Correct me here if I'm wrong. When the first Christ comes and we're still in the flesh, he is the Antichrist. Is that correct? You got it. That's We do not change into spiritual bodies until the seventh trump. That's the farthest one out. Your best study on that you can find in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 52. Take your Strong's Concordance, check out the word last trump there. It's not something made up by man. It means exactly what it is, the farthest one out. Which one is that? The seventh. A child can understand that, okay? Okay, Wayne from Iowa. I always ask for forgiveness. Does this affect my salvation? I feel like God is tired of me asking for forgiveness over and over. Oh, I see that you have one sin you just can't quite shake, okay? And that as a Christian you feel you should. Then what do? You stop asking for forgiveness and ask for help. Don't make any promises to God you can't keep. If you're weak in that one thing, you sure don't want Satan to know about it, and he probably does. You want to ask God to help you get over it, okay, to stop it. Because you need help. He hears you and he loves you. All you have to do is ask him and see what happens. Shirley from Nebraska, does Satan come in the fifth but not appear to the world until the sixth when he is in Jerusalem, or do the fallen angels come in the fifth and just lead by his influence. No, it all happens. He and his angels are cast out at the same time, okay? Now, his evil spirit is here on earth in the fifth, the fourth, the third, the second, and the first. His evil spirit is here. But de facto, he is not here until the sixth, okay? The fifth is a time of teaching and sealing in our foreheads. Again, that doesn't take away from the fact that his evil spirit is here. In God's plan, for every negative, there is a positive. And the positive is the Holy Spirit, the negative is his evil spirit. Why? Because we're supposed to know the difference. We're supposed to be able to discern them by reading the letter he has sent to us called the Word of God. And when you understand the difference, then you yourself are supposed to make that decision and make that stand, all right? Russell from Georgia. Pastor Murray, in Luke chapter 16, verses 19 through 31, is it a parable or de facto? It's a parable. It's a parable about two actual men that had walked the earth and were here on the earth, Lazarus and the rich man, so that you know what's going on in paradise. And I'm out of time, and we'll pick this up again here tomorrow, this great book of Matthew. I hope you've enjoyed it. You know, you want to stay in the Word. I love you, but most of all, God loves you for staying in that Word. It makes his day, because it's the letter he sent to you to help you be strong. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings if, and only if, we have helped you. Help us keep coming to you. Once you do that, you bless God. He will always bless you. But you know what's most important? It's this. You stay in his Word. Every day in his Word is a good day, even with trouble. You know why? Because Jesus, Yeshua, he is the living Word.
Hearing God's Word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's Word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast audio tape, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a tape catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, Post Office Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, Post Office Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at this same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.